Good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to Tennell United Methodist Church. We pray that our worship service here this morning will lift your spirit and warm your heart. Pastor Danita is on vacation this morning, but we welcome Tommy Webster, who will lead our service today. We are always delighted when Tommy can come and share his many talents with us. The flowers on the altar this morning are a gift of love and appreciation for Tommy, for all the many ways that he continues to enhance the worship services of our church. And I know that all of you will keep Tommy in your thoughts and prayers this morning as he shares the love of God through both his music and his message. As you are able, and sing together all verses of page 73, O Worship the King. recite with me our traditional affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, which is found on page 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. With mine as we pray together. Father, we come before you this morning to worship and to praise you. Each day you prove to us that you love us and that we can trust you, that you will take care of us. Thank you for your marvelous gifts of love, mercy, and grace. We ask your blessing on all those who are worshiping with us here this morning. We pray for those who are suffering from illness. May they feel your powerful healing touch. And Lord, we pray for all the people in our county who have suffered loss and property damage from our recent storm. May they feel your tender, loving hand as they face their burdens. Lord, we as your people pray for guidance as we try to live as your disciples. We desire to be your humble servants. Help us listen to you and to follow the examples given to us from the life of Jesus. For we pray these things in the name of our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our offertory hymn this morning is Trust and Obey. It's found on page 467 in your Methodist hymnal. Please stand as you're able and sing together all verses of page 467, Trust and Obey.
Thank you.
everything we have comes from you. We ask that you take these, our tithes and offerings, and use them to build your kingdom. Help us to be generous givers, Lord. Give us of our money, our lives, that we might make a positive difference in this world. We ask this in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave his all that we might have eternal life. Amen. Doxology.
No more clouds in the sky.
Our hymn of preparation this morning is found on page 605 in your Methodist hymnal. Now, you may not be familiar with the words to this song, "Wash, O God, our sons and daughters," but maybe you will recognize the melody. Please stand as you are able and sing all verses of page 605, "Wash, O God, our sons and daughters."
So nice, and I know what it's like to be in your position, so in case you get bored with the sermon, I gave you a little doodle sheet that you can just draw on. But if you want to pay attention, on the front side is our scripture for the day. We've been through Advent, and we've learned about Jesus coming as a child, and so today we kind of fast forward. We don't know much about his early life, but we're going to fast forward to when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. So I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of God's word. If you are able, one more time, we're going to read Matthew 3, 13 through 17, and that's printed on your sheet there in front of you. Stand as you're able. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for this is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." May God add his blessing to the hearing and the reading of his word. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Now we see an interaction with John and Jesus as Jesus comes to be baptized himself. We look at this passage today, and I want us to look at three pictures of Jesus. The first one is a picture of Jesus' faithfulness. There in verse 13, I'll read that again. Then Jesus came to Galilee, to the Jordan, to John, to be baptized by him. Why would he do this? Why would Jesus want to be baptized? This is certainly surprising to us, and it was certainly surprising to John. Jesus tells us in this passage that this was to fulfill all righteousness. So Jesus indicates that in some manner he is supposed to be baptized by John in order to fulfill his mission. Even though Jesus is the Messiah, even though he is the Son of God, and even though he is accelerating the kingdom of God, even though he should be baptizing John, even though his baptism is more powerful than what baptism John gives, he goes to John. You see, Jesus was being faithful to what the Father had called him to do. He was placing himself among humankind and humbling himself to be baptized as other followers of Jesus were doing. So that bears the question, are we being faithful to what God has called us to do after our baptism, no matter how long ago it was? So we see Jesus being faithful, but also in John's response to Jesus, we're giving a picture of Jesus' lordship. Look at verse 14 through 15 again. But John tried to stop him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and yet you come to me? Jesus answered him, allow it for now, because this is the way for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then John allowed him to be baptized. Bear in mind that this is John the Baptist. He was kind of a woolly booger for a little while in his life. Jesus himself, though, would later say about John, there is no greater who was born of a woman than John the Baptist. Yet John is still floored at the thought of baptizing Jesus. He says, I should be baptized by you. So right there, John recognizes that Jesus is his Lord. And we must recognize in our daily lives that Jesus is Lord. John has already said, I'm not even worthy to touch your shoes. Yet Jesus says that this has to happen in order for him to fulfill his purpose. This has to happen to fulfill his righteousness. What does Jesus mean by that statement? Kurt Richardson, in his commentary on Matthew, says, to fulfill all righteousness means to complete everything that forms part of a relationship of obedience to God. In short, Jesus must do this in order to accomplish the righteous purpose for which he came. But let's be clear about this. Jesus didn't need to be baptized in order to be righteous, did he? Jesus is already perfectly righteous and without sin. Remember, even those who were coming to be baptized by John were doing so after they had repented and turning from their sin and committing a new way of life to follow God, to follow Jesus, this master. Jesus had no need to repent from sin, but he was publicly committing to God's way through baptism. So why would Jesus be baptized? It reminds me of a preacher at a revival years ago. He took his congregants down to the river, and a drunk was walking by. And so he went straight to the water with the pastor, and he said, I want to be baptized. He said, you're ready to follow Jesus. He said, I'm ready. He said, you're ready to find Jesus. He said, yes. He dunks him in. He says, have you found Jesus? And he said, no. So he dunks him in again. He said, have you found Jesus? And he said, no. So exasperated, the pastor dunks him again, holds him in there for about 30 seconds and brings him up and says, now have you found Jesus? He said, no, but I'm not sure this is where he fell in. So, but that doesn't answer the question, does it? See, baptism isn't where you find Jesus. It's what you do with once you found him. If you look on your sheet, I give four reasons my little humble mind thinks that Jesus is baptized. First, he wanted to identify with human beings. How could he lead other people if not had gone through things himself? He needed to go to John to be baptized. Jesus had no reason to repent, yet I believe he wanted to identify with their humanity, as he would later represent them by taking the sins of humanity on the cross. Number two, I think he wanted to identify with his future command. Jesus would later command his followers to go out, make disciples, and baptize them. By him having been baptized himself, he brought further emphasis on the importance of baptism. Number three, I think he wanted to identify his commitment. This period in Matthew's gospel signifies the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry. We remember that Jesus started his earthly ministry. You know, we know very little about him going to temple when he was a child, but he really started earthly ministry at age 30, which was the same age that you had to be to become a priest in their day. Number four, I think he wanted to identify with his future work. Baptism signifies Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. By being baptized himself, Jesus was giving an early picture of what kind of future work he would accomplish through death and resurrection. So Jesus comes to be baptized by John. Jesus is the one who is supreme, so John wants to yield to Jesus. Yet the Lord demonstrates his lordship further by taking the form of an obedient, humble servant. In so doing, he shows that Jesus, and showing them he is the Messiah that the people truly need. And our final picture, I think, is a picture of Jesus' deity. Look at verse 16 and 17 again. When Jesus was baptized, he went up immediately from the water. The heavens suddenly opened for him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming down on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." What a magnificent picture we have here. There's so much contained in those few little words. First of all, the entire Trinity was present at this passage. Jesus, the Son, was being baptized. God the Father is speaking his approval on the baptism, and the Holy Spirit of God is descended upon Jesus like a dove. This is proof that although God is one, we see the individual members of the Trinity working together here. God is unified, yet exists in three persons. Some might say, how is this possible? We must remember that this is God we're talking about. What seems impossible to us is easy for God. We're talking about the one who made the Milky Way and all the other galaxies with just a spoken word. We're talking about the one that designed a sunset. He's able to do all things. The Trinitarian relationship of our God is one of the great mysteries, yet one of the great realities that we have in our faith. We see here in our passage that they all exist at one time. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We see through this experience that Jesus was more than just mere man. He comes up out of the water and the heavens are open, and after the sky splits, something like a dove descends upon him, and we realize this is the Holy Spirit of God. Notice it doesn't say a dove. It says like a dove. We're not sure, but the Spirit of God appeared in a way that we could recognize and come upon Jesus, anointing him further for his mission. In case that's not amazing enough, we see that an actual verse is heard as well. Could you imagine being heard, hearing the voice of God as you did something to approve what you've done? God the Father speaks and gives his approval of Jesus and his faithful obedience to his baptism and his commitment. And Jesus is not just a man, he is Lord. And God's ordaining this time. Some might say that this verse doesn't prove that Jesus is God. And so I've put a couple of verses down here for us to look at. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Well, who was the Word? Listen to John 1:14. "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We observed his glory, the glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." So the Word is God. The Word is also the Son. Further, listen to Jesus himself when questioned by the Pharisees regarding his authority. This is a little bit longer. John 8:48-59. The Jews responded to him, "Aren't we right in saying that you're a Samaritan and have a demon?" "I do not have a demon," Jesus answered. "On the contrary, I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it and judges. Truly, I tell you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." Then the Jews said, "Now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, so did the prophets. You say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophets died. Who do you claim to be?" "If I glorify myself," Jesus answered, "my glory is nothing. My Father, and whom you say, he is our God, he is the one who glorifies me. You do not know him, but I know him. If I were to say I don't know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad." Then the Jews replied, "You aren't 50 years old yet, and you've seen Abraham?" Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus was hidden and went out of the temple. Remember, God revealed himself as I am. When Jesus did this, he identified himself as Yahweh. That's why they tried to throw stones at him. Listen to Thomas's reaction to Jesus upon seeing him resurrected from the dead. Listen to John 20:24-29. "But Thomas, called Twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples were telling him, 'We've seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'If I don't see the mark of the nails in his hands, put my finger into the mark of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will never believe.' A week later, the disciples were indoors again, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here and look at my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Don't be faithless, but believe.' Thomas responded to him, 'My Lord and my God.' Jesus said, 'Because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are those who have not seen me, yet believe.'" Jesus affirmed Thomas's statement. He didn't correct it. Notice Jesus never corrected those who claimed that he was divine. He never clarified when others thought he was claiming he was divine. The entire scope of Scripture, as well as Matthew's account of Jesus' baptism, shows us that Jesus was much more than just a man or a good teacher or even the Son of God. Indeed, he is God himself in the flesh. This morning, we see these pictures of Jesus' faithfulness, his lordship, and deity. We're starting to see Jesus' ministry ramp up and starting to see that he is more than just a special child, more than just a good man, but he is Lord. So here's our bottom line for this week, I think. Jesus' baptism demonstrated his calling and commitment to his mission. We see his calling, who he really was and why he came, and we see his commitment, what he came to do. He was the Son of God. He came to save people from their sins. And I'm going to challenge us this week to examine our faithfulness to his mission, to the mission that we've been given. Jesus was totally committed to the mission that God gave him, so much that he was willing to be baptized by John when he should have been the one baptizing John. God has changed our lives and called us to mission. What mission are we called to? Are we loving God with everything that we have? Are we loving others the way we should? Are we developing disciples? So let us be challenged by God's faithfulness. And let's examine the lordship that Jesus has in our lives. John knew that there was something significant about Jesus. John felt unworthy just to be in the presence of Jesus. What kind of place do we put Jesus in our lives? Do we ever feel unworthy to come before him? What's our commitment? Matthew again and again wants us to see Jesus who he is and why he really came, this passage opens up the floodgates for us to get an idea of who he is. Having seen it now, what will we do with it? How will we be changed? And how has Jesus changed us to change others? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you that you have hidden the word on our hearts that we may not sin against you, and that we've heard it with our ears, that it may resonate to our feet to leave this place to be your hands and feet in this world, in this community, on this block. We thank you now for time gathered here, and we thank you for the joyous celebration that we have each week as we gather in your space to remember and to celebrate who you are in our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. Our final hymn is number 337, Only Trust Him. Let's stand and sing together.